In a popular video I made some years ago on the relationship between Haiti, Haitian citizens, and the Dominican Republic, I provided detailed information and nuance on the immigration conflict going on at that time between these parties, and how all that was happening was being wrongly reported by international media, and I wanted to put a Dominican and humanist perspective on the subject. To bring proper context to my analysis, in the video I described the history behind these two countries, a history that started by its indigenous people, and what was their fate once the Spanish conquistadors arrived to the Hispaniola island. In the comment section, many of my viewers, some of them Dominicans, showed their disagreement with some of the information divulged by my video, particularly on what I said about the Spaniards, on how they exterminated the natives. To my surprise, some of them said that Taínos were not exterminated, that there were still some Taíno blood in the population of the Dominican Republic. And some went to the extent to try to justify the conquistadors' behavior, saying that can be summarized as the Spaniard protecting the Taínos of the island. Although I completely disagree with that assertion, I went ahead and did some additional research and found that the vast majority of scholars who have studied the Caribbean natives have come to the same conclusion, that the Spanish conquistador exterminated the natives either by illness, by mistreatment, slavery, killing, torturing, etc. And this happened in a period of about 100 years. In this video, I will show you the result of that research, the relationship between the Spanish conquistadors and the indigenous people of the Hispaniola island, and whether there is still indigenous blood in the general population of the Greater Antilles. The indigenous peoples of the Caribbean included the Taínos, the island Caribs of the Lesser Antilles, and the Guanahabatey of western Cuba. We are going to focus on the Taínos, since there are many written documents about their behavior, culture, and civilization. Most of these documents are held in the India's archives in Spain and were recorded by priests and administrators of the Spanish colony in the Hispaniola island. The Taínos are direct descendants of South American Arawaks, indigenous people who migrated from the Upper Amazonia and the Orinoco Basin. Island hopping through the Caribbean, they established themselves in most of these islands. The island known now as Hispaniola used to be called by its people Haiti. It was inhabited by people who practiced an agrarian communism and who worshipped the fire, the sun, and the moon, and a plethora of lesser gods called semíes, who were hand-sculpted on stone and did not have any written language. The indigenous nation was not under the mandate of one government. The island was in fact divided into 5 kingdoms or cacicazgos, headed by the same amount of caciques or chieftains. Those were Marien, headed by chieftain Guacanagarix, Magua, headed by Guarionex, Higüe by Cayacoa, Maguana of Caonabo, and Jaragua by Boechillo. They were other important or powerful chiefs who had no connection to this political division. Those were Watiwana, Atue, and Mayovanex. The fact that the stories about these people were first written by Bartolomé de las Casas and later by Gonzalo Fernández de Oviedo, when almost all the indigenous people had been exterminated and most oral sources have been lost, there is much of the Hispaniola Taíno culture that we don't know and may never know. The Taínos were peaceful people, dedicated to agriculture of cassava, maize, and sweet potatoes. They were excellent fishermen, catching all kinds of fish and marine mammals such as the manatee. They also hunted all kinds of little animals throughout the island, iguanas, jutias, birds, etc. There was some kind of system of commerce between the cacicazgo and even with some other islands of the Caribbean. They were very keen to defend their liberty and independence in making decisions. There were some other different people, very hostile, that live in the eastern part of the island called Caribes. They used the bow and arrow and other weapons made out of wood, bone, and stone. They enjoy to play a game in the center of their village called La Pelota and prepare special dancing parties called areitos.
What is undeniable is that these people were beautiful. Christopher Columbus wrote about their beauty. He considered them one of the most beautiful people he has ever seen. All of them had light brown skin with long pitch black hair. Children and teenagers were naked, and after they got married, they covered their privates with skirts called naguas. They practiced polygamy, and the families lived in dwellings called bohíos. Adult male Taínos liked to chew and smoke tobacco leaves. They used clay to make all kinds of pottery, but did not have any knowledge of metalworking. But all that culture, peace and tranquility, one day suddenly changed. At the beginning of the Renaissance period, an ambitious sailor convinced a queen that there was a better route to India to get a spice, which will be less costly and provide bigger profits for her kingdom. That is, if his belief that the earth was round was true. So the queen partially believed him and provided him with 3 ships, manned by a bunch of unruly sailors, promised liberty if they went with the voyage. So the adventure to seek for another route for spices began. What the sailor didn't know was that there was a huge continent in his way, and his adventure would not turn out to be as he thought it would.
So the whole story started with a gamble, a bunch of unruly sailors, and 3 little ships. In October 12, 1492, Christopher Columbus arrived to some islands of what today is called the Bahamas, then later passed through the north of Cuba, to finally, on December 1492, disembark on an island that he equaled in beauty to Spain, so therefore he called it La Española, the Spaniard, which was later transformed into Hispaniola. This zone of the Hispaniola island was part of the Cacicazgo of Marien, where chieftain Huacanagarix ruled, and therefore was one of the first natives who received the newly arrived Christopher Columbus and his bunch.
If there was a quality that the Spaniards could highlight about these people, is their hospitality. This hospitality filled Christopher Columbus with optimism, and added to something valuable that he found, he decided to construct a settlement on this island. But since he did not find any spices on this island, why leave a settlement? It is said that the reason is Huacanagarix. When the chieftain received Columbus in the shores of his domain, he was wearing a headdress or crown made in pure gold. Christopher Columbus was wearing a red cape. Red was a color very much appreciated by the natives, and Huacanagarix offered Columbus to exchange his crown for his red cape, to which the greedy Spaniard gladly agreed. This gesture is still condemned by the population when they diagnose this behavior of preference of things and people of foreign origin against locally produced goods as the Huacanagarix complex. Once Christopher Columbus saw gold, he didn't care much for spices or the natives. Now his plan was to become rich with the gold of these savages. Therefore, he left the settlement with some of the men and went back to Spain with the news to the queen, who readily approved a new voyage with enough people and ships to control the natives and get the precious gold they had. And he was back in less than a year later with 17 ships, more than 1,000 paid men, and 300 volunteers who were hooked on the possibility to get rich on these new lands. Also, some noblemen, many horses, attack dogs and other weapons, 12 priests, and an envoy from His Sanctity the Pope. Curiously, the only thing missing from these ships were women. And why would you need them when Christopher Columbus spoke a lot about the beautiful women of these savages?
Christopher Columbus arrived to the settlement he left with 39 men. Having found all of them dead, he asked Huacanagarix, who was injured, what has happened, and he said that the Spaniards spread through the island looking for gold and raping women, and that they fought one against each other and killed themselves. The ones that were left went to the Cacicazgo Maguana, where Caonabo, who was not a nice king, killed them all, and also traveled to the fort to kill the rest. Huacanagarix and his people defended the Spaniards, and that's how they got injured. Huacanagarix gave Colón precious stones and gold for the death of his people. Colón gave in exchange some mirrors, glass, scissors, and pins to the value of 4 or 5 reales, far less than a mere gold coin. Colón moved to the east to the Cacicasco of Magua owned by Cacique Guarionex and founded the first city of the New World called Isabela in honor of his queen. He distributed land among his men so they can cultivate and start building houses, but nobody wanted to establish. Everybody were looking for gold and the beautiful naked women that they were promised. They started getting gold by exchanging trinkets for gold to the natives. But when they couldn't find any more in that area, they moved to the exploration of the rest of the island and arrived to a beautiful valley called the Cibao, and there they found gold. They took all the gold that they could from the natives. The gold Colón received from Guacanagarix and the one picked in the Cibao was all put on a ship to Spain. Colón then moved to the Cibao and opened gold mines in many places, and that's when the hostility between the natives and the Spaniards started. No later after that, there was a big confrontation in the Cibao where the Spaniard captured 500 Indians, which were later shipped to Spain as slaves. And they established a new law that for every Spaniard killed, there have to be 100 Indians killed. And in the space of 7 years, all the Indians were conquered by the ambitious Spaniards.
Gold mines were opened and Taínos were enslaved to mine the ore. Spanish priest Bartolomé de las Casas, who accompanied Columbus on his second voyage, spoke out against the cruel treatment of the Taíno people. It is not possible to recount the 100th part of what I've seen with my own eyes. A man have meant to have a body of iron to undergo the labor they endure in getting gold out of the mines. They must delve and search 100 times over in the alien parts of the mountains until they dig a mouth from the top to bottom. They must work the very rocks hollow. Bartolomé de las Casas.
The Columbuses had absolute power over the island, receiving the highest title of Viceroy. All of the Columbuses, Christopher plus his two brothers, Bartolomé and Diego, were ruthless against the natives. While Christopher Columbus went to the Cibao to conquer the Indians, steal their gold, and submit them to slavery in the gold mines, he left as governor in La Isabela his brother, Bartolomé Colón. Because of the suffering, illness, and death plaguing the city of La Isabela on the north, and having some of its citizens offended Christopher Columbus' brother, Bartolomé Colón, they fled to the south of the island, and having found an excellent natural port in the mouth of a river called Ozama, and there they established their colony. And in 1496, the insult was forgiven by Bartolomé Colón, and all of the people from La Isabela moved to the newly found city. On August 5th, 1496, the city of Santo Domingo was founded, but the ruthless way they treated the natives and some of their fellow Spaniards was reported to the King and Queen of Spain. By the year 1500, the King and Queen of Spain were sick and tired of the crimes and misdemeanors of the Columbuses, so they named a new governor to the island called Bobadilla, who hated Christopher Columbus. So he has him and his brother arrested. And that's how Christopher Columbus' history ended. He died in May 20th of 1506 in Valladolid, Spain. In his last will, he requested that his remains be returned to the island of La Española. Bartolomé de la Casa said that there were 16,000 people living in the Hispaniola island when he arrived in 1508, including the Indians. So that from 1494 to 1508, over 3 million people had perished from war, slavery, and the mines. Who in future generations will believe this? Bartolomé de las Casas in his History of the Indies. Although these figures seem a little bit exaggerated, the truth of the matter is that by 1508, less than 16,000 Hispaniola natives were alive. The fact of this genocide is undeniable, but since the first and second trip of Christopher Columbus, there were not any European women in these ships. What happened with all the indigenous females that this Spaniard raped or married? Well, their kids are called mestizos, which is a mix of white with indigenous. When a white mix with a black person, their descendants are called mulatos. By 1514, barely 2 decades after their first contact, an official survey showed that 40% of Spanish men had taken Indian wives. The unofficial number is undoubtedly higher. because of the outcry of one Catholic priest called Fray Antón of Montesinos against the abuse the Indians were suffering. The king decreed a series of laws to stop this abuse, that included recognizing the liberty of the natives, importing slaves from Africa to substitute the work of the natives, and put the ones that were still alive under the care of Spaniards with a system called encomiendas. Putting the fact aside that the encomiendas were another form of slavery, this was too little too late. They were less than 20,000 Indians by that time. By 1530, just 36 years after the so-called discovery, the situation was so horrible for the natives of the Hispaniola island that one of the few leaders they had, the cacique Enriquillo, went to the mountains to establish some kind of guerrilla warfare against the Spaniards. Enriquillo, one of the last Taínos cacique, led some 600 followers. The rest of the island had somewhere around 5,000 pure Indians. 10 years later, they have all but disappeared from the Hispaniola island. Only mestizos were left. So there is your conclusion. There aren't any more pure Taínos in the Greater Antilles. A recent nationwide genetic study established that 15 to 18% of Dominicans had Amerindian markers in their mitochondrial DNA, testifying to the continued presence of Taíno genes. Another study published in 2003 by Martinez Cruzado, a biologist at the University of Puerto Rico, announced the island-wide genetic study took samples from 800 randomly selected subjects, and it gave results of 61% of those surveyed had mitochondrial DNA of indigenous origin. The same study revealed African markers in 26.4% of the population and 12.5% of those of European descent. How come two island-wide studies, one in the Hispaniola island and another in Puerto Rico, get so different results? 15 to 18% against 61%. Since the Hispaniola island had by far the largest Taíno population, the results obtained in that island-wide study are considered more accurate than the one made in the Puerto Rico island. The truth of the matter is that in Puerto Rico, the question of Indian identity is often fraught with political implications, because it means a special treatment by the government of the United States. Because of that, there is a prevailing interest in Puerto Rican to be called Taínos, and that has permeated some of the Dominican communities in the United States. So this story that there are still Taínos in our island basically was promoted by people looking for federal subsidy.
The truth of the matter is that all of these cultures and genes are mixed inside of all of Dominicans, Cubans, Puerto Ricans, and Haitians. And probably if you come from these islands, you might have some Taíno genes. We all do. But the fact remains that they are not more pure Taínos. And most likely, the percentage of pure Taíno DNA in our blood is less than 12%. So get off the high horse. You are not pure white. You are not pure black. You are not pure Taíno. Although in the United States you could be called Hispanic, the fact is that you are Caribbean, Latino or Latin American. Embrace it and feel proud about it.
Hololipa Resonance Science could use your help. Using the links in the description box below, you can donate via PayPal or support the channel via Patreon. It will be greatly appreciated. Thank you for watching.